Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Tickle Trunk of Horrors. I'm Timothy Mark with Alexandria.
How's everybody doing today?
And today is St. George's Day. And so I want to say happy St. George to everybody. Here's a little bit of a song that they play during this day in celebration.
St. George slew the dragon on a white horse with his lance. It made a pretty picture, brought England true romance. St. George was born near Bethlehem in the 4th century. He was a Roman soldier who found Christianity. St. George, you're my hero, slew a dragon just for me. He did it by the grace of God who set my soul free. St. George, you're my hero, slew a dragon just for me. You did it by the grace of God, set my soul free.
Okay, so that's a little bit of the song that they play on this day to celebrate St. George's holiday. And again, we are the Tickle Trunk of Horrors, and this show plays on many different platforms: Spreaker.com, YouTube, Tumblr, and iTunes. If you're one of the people, the few people that actually listen to this on YouTube, because we get a majority of our listeners from Spreaker.com, but if you do listen to this on YouTube, like the podcast show and subscribe to our channel.
And we'd like to thank everybody that is listening and sharing all the podcasts. And we're very, very excited in regards to the podcast series for the Tickle Trunk of Horrors.
And so, as the Tickle Trunk of Horrors, Alexandria's got a list of movies that she's going to say that was released on this date so long ago.
I just wanted to let everybody know, today, April 23rd, this is sort of a short list of horror films that were released on this day. The original Legend of Sleepy Hollow, 1912. The Vanishing Shadow, 1933. Touch of Evil, 1958. Rattlers, 1976. Carnage, 1984. A Stephen King film, The Dark Half, 1993. Zombie Honeymoon, 2004, and Beyond Reanimator, 2003, folks.
There you go. So that's your horror dose of horror for today, because today we're going to focus on St. George. And so, being Alexandria's the historian, she will be leading this one off.
And I want to say congratulations to the British royal family. This is a show about England and English patron saint, that the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge welcomed another boy to their little herd now. And they have a little boy born on St. George's Day. And I'm sort of going to go into, I treat these podcasts from the historical point of view, as people really don't know anything about a subject. So it's always good to give information in regards to St. George. And really, St. George is England's patron saint. He's a 4th century Christian martyr, and he's also a patron saint of Georgia and the city of Moscow, if you didn't know that. Very little factual information is known about the real St. George. So St. George was a real person, folks. He is thought to have been born into a noble Christian family in the late 3rd century in an area which is now Turkey. He followed his father's profession of a soldier, and he became part of the retinue of the emperor. I'm not even going to begin to pronounce it. It's Diocletian. And the emperor ordered the systematic persecution of Christians, and George absolutely refused to take part. And in 303, he himself was tortured, executed in Palestine, and he became an early Christian martyr. And the legend of George slaying a dragon and rescuing an innocent maiden from death is medieval. So this was it within medieval times that the dragon came into play. When you see the images of Saint George slaying a dragon, it wasn't when he was first thought of. It was purely a medieval idea. And St. George's Day is celebrated in England on April 23rd, and that's reputed to be the day of his martyrdom in 303.
And here's a little fun fact for you. The Sci-Fi Channel did a historical fantasy film based on St. George, and it was called George and the Dragon. And it actually looks like a pretty good film. It definitely is one that I want to check out. It has Patrick Swayze in there, although he's not the lead actor. The lead is Piper Perabo. And so there's probably a lot of English people listening from England over there that know of the film, but I haven't actually seen it yet. But that's just a little fun fact for you.
And to get back to St. George's Day, it is also known as the Feast of St. George and is the feast day of St. George as celebrated by various Christian churches and by various several nations, kingdom, and countries and cities in which St. George is a patron saint. And I was there's a very beautiful oil painting by Raphael, St. George and the Dragon as well. And this particular holiday or this day is observed by Roman Catholic churches, Lutheran churches, Anglican Communion, Eastern Orthodox churches, even Oriental Orthodox churches, and nations of which St. George, again, is their patron saint. And it's a feast day, and during this particular day, there's church services, and everybody flies the St. George's cross as well. And it's an annual holiday, and it is a white, the background of the flag is white with a red cross, and it goes on to the English. It's the flag of England. The flag of England, again, is St. George's cross, and the celebrations incorporate that cross as well. And if we go into a lot of more of the history, the earliest documented mention of St. George in England comes from the Catholic monk Bede. And his feast day is also mentioned in the Durham Collectar, a 9th century liturgical work as well.
And by the 14th century, the saint had been declared both a patron saint and the protector of the royal family.
And to kind of bring history to the forefront, St. George's Day, if you could just picture this in your mind of what really happens on St. George's Day. St. George's Day was a major feast and national holiday in England on par with Christmas from the earliest 15th century, and the tradition of celebration of St. George's Day had waned and really kind of gone downhill a bit by the end of the 18th century after the union of England and Scotland. And nevertheless, the link with St. George continues today. There's various pageants that go on and feasts that go on as well, and St. George Day is a public holiday in England as well. There's dancing, different kind of celebrations, and it is a traditional custom on St. George's Day to fly, again, the St. George's Day cross in some way, shape, or form. And pubs in particular can be seen on the 23rd of April with garlands of St. George's Day crosses. And it is also customary for the hymn Jerusalem to be sung in cathedrals, churches, and chapels on St. George's Day, or actually the Sunday that is the closest to St. George's Day. And of course, traditional English food and drink may be consumed as well.
Yeah, so this guy was actually a Roman soldier and never set foot in England himself, but definitely was considered to be a protector of the royal family, and not just in England but also in Romania. And so there's a lot of people that look highly, a lot of countries that look highly upon this guy.
And he we have to keep in mind too that the dragon was really brought into the story within medieval times, so it wasn't at the beginning of the story. It just that's when it was, you know, he was a soldier again in the Roman army who again in medieval times killed a dragon and saved a princess. So there's been so many legends and stories in regards to him slaying a dragon as well.
But here's a question, here's an answer to a question that I had, and now I understand my question has been answered, because slaying of the dragon did not make this man a saint. And here's a question. How did George become a saint, a patron saint, England's patron saint? It's easy. He was tortured by the emperor, and I can't pronounce his name, Diocletian. He was tortured by him to make him deny Christ, and he would never deny Christ. So he was tortured to death. And because of that, him keeping his faith and never denying Christ, he became a saint.
And quite interesting when I mentioned too that the hymn Jerusalem is sang at a lot of, or sung at a lot of church ceremonies in regards to St. George's Day. Jerusalem was actually written by the poet William Blake. And it is supposed in this poem that the words described a supposed visit to Glastonbury, England, by Jesus Christ during his youth. So that's what William Blake wrote about in the hymn Jerusalem. And St. George, again, was a soldier. He rose up through the ranks, and really he was executed again for being a Christian. And it says that he is buried in the town of Lod in Israel. And again, today, you know, every time we think about St. George's Day, even in Canada, in the two provinces, Newfoundland and Labrador, St. George's Day is celebrated. But according to the legend, the only well in the town of, it's S-I-L-E-N-E, was guarded by a dragon. And in order to get water, the inhabitants of the town had to offer a human sacrifice every day to the dragon, and the person to be sacrificed was chosen by drawing lots. And on the day that St. George was visiting, a princess had been selected to be sacrificed. However, St. George killed the dragon, saved the princess, and gave the people of this town access to water. And in gratitude, they converted to Christianity. And it is thought that the dragon represents a certain type of pagan belief that included the sacrifice of human beings. So that's where the legend of the dragon and St. George saving the princess from the dragon.
Did you just mention the apostles at all?
No, I haven't. Okay.
Well, the earliest sources about St. George said that he lived among a group of believers who were in direct contact with the last apostles of Jesus. He was described as a rich merchant who opposed the erection of Apollo's statue. And so, you know, he would have more deeper understanding of who Jesus was if he was with the last apostles of Jesus.
And it's quite interesting, too, that St. George is the patron saint of a number of other places, such as Bulgaria, Ethiopia, Georgia, Greece, Portugal, and Russia. And he's also, again, remembered in regional holidays, again, I mentioned Newfoundland and Labrador provinces in Canada. And very, very interesting. And there are symbols that are associated with St. George's Day. Again, is St. George's cross. And this is a red cross on a white background, which is often displayed as a flag, and is used as England's national flag, forming part of the Union Jack. Very, very interesting in that as well. And this is another tidbit that Timothy had brought into during the Crusades in the 1100s and the 1200s, English knights used St. George's cross as part of their uniform. So crusaders from England used St. George's cross as part of their Templar uniform. And it has been the official flag of England for centuries. And again, very, very interesting. And there's a lot of places that observe this particular holiday. And again, he's a Christian martyr and a soldier in the Roman army. Very, very interesting.
Yeah, the Cross of St. George is actually an award, a medal that's given out in some countries to be the highest civil distinctions. And so, yeah, if you're awarded the St. George Cross, that's a pretty high award in a lot of military circles.
And I think it's quite interesting, too, that St. George is the patron saint in England, and then we have another patron saint is St. Patrick in Ireland that drove the snakes out of Ireland as well. So, I mean, St. George, again, is known as a dragon slayer, and it is also April 23rd is the anniversary of William Shakespeare's death as well, birth. And his death as well. So that's really, really interesting in regards to St. George. And really, if we have to dissect the legend of St. George, he really represents traditional English chivalry and bravery. Even though he wasn't England, he wasn't British, he wasn't English, and he probably never set foot in England as well, but the English really took St. George under their wing and made him a real symbol for their nation as well. So very, very interesting, and in regards to so many different paintings and references in regards to St. George, of course, slaying a dragon. So it's another interesting, or maybe a gory fact for all of you horror fans. This is a legend that after he was imprisoned, tortured, and dragged through the streets, and then finally beheaded in Palestine, his head was taken to and stored in the church dedicated to him in Rome. And again, the rest of his body was buried headless in Israel. And another interesting fact is Saint George stayed loyal to his faith until the very, very end. And apparently the emperor's wife was so inspired by his bravery that she too became a Christian, and she was also executed. So the emperor's wife became a Christian, and then she was executed for feeling sorry or turning, you know, a Christian like Saint George was. So
there was a sacred military Constantinian order of Saint George, and it was established between 1520 and 1545 AD. And so that was established by Constantine the Great.
That's an interesting fact I didn't know.
There's an old order of St. George that's named the Order of the Four Emperors, established by Count Philip Ferdinand of Limburg, Styrium in 1768. There's a lot of military orders for St. George, being that he was clearly a warrior of his time.
And, you know, to put this in perspective as well, the fairy tale of St. George and the Dragon really has captivated millions and millions of children over the years all over the world. And while some of the stories of St. George are believed to be fictitious at the time, his inspiring strength and dedication to his faith and morals were recognized by everybody in Europe. So really what I'm getting from this is St. George stood for strength and dedication of his faith and his morals, and he refused to back down, and he was actually executed and tortured for his faith.
There's a I got a fun fact film for you. The Magic Sword in 1962 was a 1962 American fantasy film, and it was based off loosely based off of Saint George and the Dragon.
Wow. And it was King Edward III who made St. George the patron saint of England in 1315, and after he formed the Order of the Garter in his name. And King Henry V, who was the King of England from 1413 to 1422, was hugely supportive of St. George. So much so, he stated in his pre-battle speech, "Cry God for Harry, England, and St. George." Very, very interesting. And St. George's cross's emblem, which is England's flag, was adopted by Richard the Lionheart and brought to England in the 12th century, and his king's soldiers wore it on their uniforms during battle to avoid confusion. So they wanted to set themselves apart from that.
So here's a question for you. If St. George is a protector of the royal family in England, because there is royal families in other countries as well, but we're specifically talking about the one in England. What happened the night that the guy scaled the fence and the queen woke up to the man sitting on the queen's bed? It actually made the, it was an embarrassment to the military and the protection services of the queen over in England at the time, that this man was able to scale the walls and actually make it to the foot of the queen's bed and sit down.
Wow, that's pretty interesting. Wow.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy.
So we have a gentleman here who was a Roman soldier, who was later a Christian, never set foot probably on British or English soil, and yet today we have people all over England celebrating St. George's Day. And again, various pubs decorate their establishments by using the St. George's cross. They offer people the chance to celebrate together with a few drinks, and there's parades, dancing, waving the flags from buildings and pubs, and some people actually will wear a rose on St. George's Day, England's national flower on their lapel. And there's also a St. George's Day festivals around London, with many people choosing to celebrate in parks. And the main event taking place in the capital this year is in the Mayor of London's feast. So very, very, you know, these are high, it's actually a huge celebration where people get together in regards to this martyred saint.
Yes, and so there you go. And there's a lot of history on the saint. There's a lot of history on him.
And other countries in Albania also celebrate and represent their joy by lighting fires and playing around it. In Croatia, fires are lit on St. George's Day to mark the first day of spring. In Spain, a public holiday is held for St. George, and roses and books are exchanged by lovers. That's a tradition that I had no idea in Spain on St. George's Day, that roses and books are exchanged by lovers. And in Bulgaria, it is a tradition to roast a whole lamb, because St. George is the patron saint also of shepherds. And in Ethiopia, St. George is known as the patron saint of saints, and they celebrate it on May 1st with a public holiday. Very, very interesting on some of the things that people do on St. George's Day.
Yes, and what I wanted to do was go over what it is to be a patron saint. And is a patron saint is a saint who is a Roman Catholicism, Eastern Orthodox, or particular branches of Islam. So even in Islam, you can have patron saints. And that being said, an interesting fact is, in Islam, they do recognize St. George. So the Islam community does recognize St. George.
And you know, there's an ongoing debate that still continues today over England's choice of national figureheads, and some feeling that George should be replaced by Edmund or another candidate more closely associated with England, like St. Alban, who is revered as the first British Christian martyr. So a lot of people, there's an ongoing debate saying that he should not be the patron saint because he was never in Britain. And St. George is also the saint of soldiers, archers, cavalry, farmers, while his invocation is said to help those beset by plague, leprosy, or even syphilis. And again, they're talking about when the towns, talking about when George was saving the princess. And again, in England, the date of George's execution coincides again with the birth and death of William Shakespeare.
So William Shakespeare, as we know, worked for the King James, who did the the King James Version Bible. A lot of people may not know that, but it's true. And so I never did get to finish, but the definition of a patron saint: a saint to whose protection and intercession a person, a society, a church, or a place is dedicated, an original leader or prime exemplar. And so that's the official definition so of a patron saint.
And, you know, just to kind of put this is a statement that I find totally relevant in regards to sort of a characteristic or characterizing St. George. And we have to put it into this perspective. After all, he was an immigrant from a very diverse background who fought for his adopted cause without compromising his beliefs. And he was mixing with people across Europe in the Roman legions and knew the pain and sorrow of being victimized for his principles. So he actually knew what that was. And again, going more into
then I would question his loyalty to the Roman Empire at the time, and I would question his ability to perform as a Roman soldier. And I say that because I'm a veteran myself, and if you're showing compassion for people, especially if you look at the history of the Roman Empire and how they took over so many countries, and if he's showing compassion to people, then he's not fully dedicated to the Roman Empire, and he was not able to fully perform his job as a Roman soldier for the simple fact that how can you really perform your job in the way that they were taking over countries at the time if you were compassionate towards the people?
Well, he just, what he did is that he just took a stand for something that he believed in, and he was actually tortured and killed for his beliefs. He refused to back down on what he truly believed. And I think that's that says something there in itself in regards to standing up. And we should still use that all today in regards to standing up for what you truly, truly believe in. And I think that's totally relevant in regards to seeing atrocities, even though you're a Roman soldier, seeing atrocities and just didn't want to have any part of it. And if you can even symbolize St. George and his trusty white steed and his dense suit of armor, it's just absolutely, you know, when you think of England, and I may stand corrected on this, when you think of England, you think of rainy weather, drinking tea, and St. George. That's the first thing that comes to mind with a lot of people when they think about St. George.
Well, if you mention the word England to me, I think of Keeping Up Appearances. That was a very good television show. I know it's kind of off topic, but I think that's probably what life was like in England. Wasn't that filmed in England?
Yes, it was.
Yeah, so I really liked that show.
And another interesting tidbit in regards to St. George is St. George first came to the public attention in 1483 in a book called The Golden Legend. And according to the BBC, the text was a translation of the book by a French bishop. So that's a very interesting tidbit in regards to St. George. And again, he is said to be upper class, and he earned a real reputation as a protector of Christianity and refusing to comply
and
with
that
orders.
Would be the key to why he became a saint, folks, a patron saint. And so regardless of, and it's great that they got movies and poetry and books and songs about him slaying a dragon, but the real reason he became a saint is because he did not deny his faith in Jesus Christ, and he definitely was a protector of Christianity.
So, I mean, to me, I think that's very, very relevant in regards to everybody in England raising their glass in honor of the nation's patron saint. And, I mean, I think it's everybody, there's a lot of people that are toasting him and, remembering this individual that was standing up for the rights of the people.
If there's anybody out there who knows where his head is located and knows where his body is located, can you put them back together? Because ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And, you know, there's a passage in the Bible that kind of confuses me. The passage in the Bible says this: I think it was Jesus that said this, or somebody said this. They said, if something on your body causes you to sin, cut it off, because it's better to go into heaven without it than to live on earth with it. And so my thought is, if you lose something on earth, you're not going to take it to heaven with you because of that passage that I read in the Bible. So if this man doesn't have his head, it would be great if, I disagree with this Christian belief system of separating the head and the body. I mean, granted, if people are beheaded, I mean, I think everything should be buried in one place.
And did you mention this fact, or what's your thought on this fact where St. George was also revered in Islam as well? So I guess,
yeah, I did mention that.
And I think that's an interesting fact about that.
That's why I was talking about, okay, there's different types of saints. There's saints that the Catholic Church makes as saints, which will not be recognized by the Islam. But this St. George was a patron saint. And as a patron saint, he was recognized and respected from Islam. And so that is a pretty good point. But yeah, I already covered that.
Oh, that's good to know. So, I mean, we hope that we gave you a lot of interesting tidbits in regards to St. George and sort of where the holiday comes from. And I know a lot of you in the UK were celebrating today. And we hope we gave you a history on the patron saint and some, you know, the flag that has flown and a little bit of a history. And again, folks, remember that the legend of the dragon, slaying the dragon, is from medieval times. And it is a legend in regards to that. And again, this is a feast day where there's a lot of celebrating going on. And it kind of brings to the forefront in my mind that this is really a legend in regards to an individual that probably never even set foot in England at that time.
Yeah, so I want to cover some lesser known saints that you might not know. As again, I said, there are many different types of saints, and one of them is folk saints. That does not have to be a saint approved by the Catholic Church. Then you have holy unmercenaries. Then you have military saints. Then you have, believe it or not, wonder workers, which be like miracle workers. And so that's pretty interesting.
So if anybody has any comments or any other relevant information that they want to share with us on St. George's Day, put it in the comment section. We'd like to hear from you as well.
Yeah, you can. If anybody out there knows the history of that dang, I almost cussed, but I'm going to say dang, that dragon out there, let us know. Put it in the comment section. If there's something that we didn't cover about St. George, put it in the comment section. Let us know. We're over here in the continent of America, North America. So, you know, we're not as familiar with some of the stories of St. George. Maybe y'all know more. Maybe y'all put it in the comment section. We do take a look at the comment sections. So it'd be awesome to read some of y'all's stuff. If you are in England, listen to this, comment.
And like we've said on several occasions in this podcast, very little is known about the real St. George. And there's a lot of legends, a lot of myths around there, but very little is really known in regards to. And this year as well, it's going to hold a special meaning because of the royal baby's birth today as well. So it's going to be extra celebrated, not just for the patron saint, but just for the fact of the royal family as well.
They had to plan that. They planned to pop that thing out today.
Well, I don't think a baby is always. I mean, there's no way you can force a kid out. Being a mother myself, so
they got medicine.
They
did something to make that baby born on St. George's Day.
Well, they certainly can't call him George because there is a Prince George already, so they're going to have to think of another name. And I mean, it's just it'll be interesting in regards to what his name will be. He's fifth in line to the throne now.
Right, call him Timothy. That's my name. You can call him Timothy. I gave you permission. Use the name. You can use the name.
So we've covered a lot of things about St. George's Day, symbols, who he was, and where the dragon legend comes from. And that's why a lot of children love the tale of the dragon as well. So they all know what's going on in that as well. So that was sort of an informative podcast, but we thought it was very important to celebrate and observe a lot of what everybody considers St. George's Day. Some of you in North America may not even know who the Dragon Slayer is.
Yeah.
And there's also a celebration, too, as well, at his tomb in Israel on today, which is April 23rd, at the tomb of St. George in Israel. There's somebody that's done they do actually do a church service at his tomb in Israel. So I thought that was quite interesting in regards to that.
There you go. If y'all doing all these services, put the parts of the man back together.
Well, I mean, come on.
You can find them, put them back together. I just think that having people's heads away from their bodies is not a good thing. But again, we are the Tickle Trunk of Horrors, and tomorrow is Tuesday, right?
Yes, it is.
So Wednesday, the 25th of April, we have a very special guest. That guest is going to be Belinda Balaski. And if anybody's heard of the movie The Howling, anybody's heard of the movie Gremlins, Piranha? She was in those movies, and she's definitely going to be on the show. She was in more movies than that, way more movies than that in television shows, but she's going to be on our show on Wednesday. At Thursday, we have in Residential Haunts from the UK, Ian Vero, if I'm pronouncing his name right, he's going to be on the show. And he actually lives in Hastings, England,
England,
right?
Yes,
Hastings,
he does.
England. And that is the hometown of Aleister Crowley.
Wow, that's I didn't. I'm glad that we're gonna have somebody that you can talk about your book. Timothy wrote a book on Aleister Crowley, so that's gonna be a very, very interesting podcast to speak to somebody, a paranormal team in the UK. So really, really looking forward to that.
And again, we reach out to people from around the world, and we're trying to get paranormal companies from around the world and many different countries on the show. There is time zone differences, so we try to work it out. But yeah, okay, so we pretty much wrapped up with St. George there.
I think we did. We've covered pretty well everything that is known. Like I said, he's not too much is really known about him. We can just give you some food for thought for you to speculate. And for all those that are in England that celebrate, I hope you're having a really good day, but you're drinking responsibly and you're feasting and you're listening to the hymn Jerusalem. So celebrating the saint or the patron. He's a dragon slayer of that legend. So very, very interesting in regards to, learning some information as well.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to, I don't know if in the beginning of this I mentioned the Patrick Swayze movie. I don't remember, but there is a Patrick Swayze movie. Well, hell, I guess it's called George and the Dragon. I can't remember the name of it now. I can't find it, but it's George and the Dragon. That's what I think it is, anyway. So, yeah.
That's very interesting. There's been a lot of movies about that, so a lot of kids are interested in that. So, look up more on St. George's Day and what it means to people and do your own research on it. And, again, there was a film, there was a sci-fi film in 2004 called George and the Dragon.
Yeah, that's
and
what I was
that's
just...
That's what you're just talking about. I'm trying to look it up for you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
I'm trying to look it up for you, and it's... historical fantasy film based in a medieval England, and it's loosely based on the legend of St. George and the Dragon as well. And it is starring Patrick Swayze, as Timothy indicated, so that's a movie in regards to called George and the Dragon as well.
So you said the name of the hymn is...
Jerusalem.
The Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Jerusalem hymn. So, yeah. So, anyway... this is a pretty short topic today, I guess, because we still got plenty of time left.
Well, we're used to having guests and stuff, and we thought we'd take a break as we get ready for all these guests that we're going to have on. And talk about St. George and St. George's Day, and you know, just to bring some information and kind of pay homage to this particular holiday in England, as we are going to be having paranormal groups from England join us as well. And it's a fascinating topic, because as a child, I'm sure a lot of you have had stories told to you about dragon slayers as well.
So we're going to let you listen to the Jerusalem hymn right now. And I'm hoping that this is the correct hymn that I'm playing, but let's see. Hopefully. Again, it's the hymn called Jerusalem. Cannot understand one word they said.
And I thought I'd throw this out there for a lot of you that like dragon movies, some other dragon movies. The Magic Sword from 1962, of course.
I talked about that one as well.
That's right.
The very beginning of the show. Yeah.
Dragonheart.
All right, Dragonheart. No, I did not mention that one. That, ain't that a Dennis Quaid movie?
Dragonheart, there's 1996, Dennis Quaid, Sean Connery's in there. And another dragon movie is Fire and Ice, The Dragon Chronicles, 2008. So there's been a lot of movies out there in regards to dragons, folks. So we invite you to further investigate St. George's Day, other patron saints, and all the dragon movies out there, folks. So enjoy your day. And
we're not done yet, are we?
In the coming days, we're going to have various guests joining us, and we're looking forward to all these high-profile guests. Very excited about Tickle Trunk of Horrors, our new podcast series. And you know what? Comment on the videos if you like them. Like and share them, and we appreciate all the support. So thank you very much for joining us, and enjoy your St. George's Day.
Bye.